نستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله يا أيها الذين آمنوا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد الحمد لله رب العالمين all praise be to Allah we thank him and glorify his sublime name عز وجل we ask him to send blessings and peace and salutation upon the best of creation our master Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and all the prophets and messengers alayhi wasallam ajma'in alhamdulillah rabbil alamin one of the principles that we learned repeatedly from our teachers is a statement by one of the Andalusian scholars of several centuries ago that says al adab ma Allah an la tarud alayhi ma a'taak al adab ma Allah an la tarud alayhi ma a'taak the respect and etiquette and comportment and good manners with the divine, with Allah Azza wa Jal, is to not reject and cast back to him, throw back at him what he gives you. Is to not throw back at Allah what he gives you. And this is both, firstly, in terms of what he gives us in the sacred law, what he has legislated for us, that provides us our moral and ethical compass in this life, the prophetic way, the way of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and all the prophets beforehand, although the details are specific to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that this is at one level. And at another level, the realities and circumstances of our lives. Allah Ta'ala is also giving those things to us. This is from Allah Azza wa Jal. There is a level of Sharia and a level of Haqiqa. Our scholars explain there is a surface level of the world, which is one of human choice, which is a reality, free will, and therefore the moral accountability of every human being, and therefore law and order in society. That's at one level, and we affirm that, and all prophets taught that. But at a deeper level, everything is destined from Allah. Everything that occurs in the world is destined from Allah Azza wa Jal eternally. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything eternally that will happen in the cosmos. Allah ta'ala chooses everything eternally that will happen in the cosmos. وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ Even our decisions, mysteriously, and we don't want to enter into this mystery, that it's something that our scholars teach us not to enter into, it's not something we can fit into the cognitive categories of the aql, which is called the sirr al-qadr, the secret of the divine decree vis-a-vis human choice. It's one of the mysteries. And there are logical and rational and philosophical ways of unpacking it that are satisfying to the aql, but this is not the context for that. It's something we acknowledge both the surface level and the deeper level. The level of sharia, the level of haqiqa, the level of cause and effect in the world, and the level of ultimate reality, which is a reflection of the divine will eternally decreed by Allah Azza wa Jal. And then of course, Qudratullah, the fact that everything that is occurring in the world goes back to the power of Allah. Wallahu khaliqu kulli shay. Allah is the creator of every single thing, every circumstance, every event, every occurrence in the world. Kulla yawmin huwa fi sha'n. At every moment Allah Ta'ala is engaged in an affair. At every moment Allah Ta'ala is engaged directly in an affair. And so we affirm both of these realities, both of these levels of understanding the world. And so at the surface level, we put the work in to alleviate suffering. We put the work in to better the situation of ourselves, our families, our communities, society at large. We do what we can to promote good and to promote beauty and to promote light and to promote alleviation from suffering. But all the while, the heart recognizes that all of this is decree. And that is what we don't reject. We don't reject the qada of Allah. While we work to solve problems in the world, we affirm and we accept and we are content with what Allah has destined for us. This is the way of the Prophet ﷺ. And this is the way of our Prophet ﷺ. As he taught us in is the hadith that Tirmidhi relates, that the Prophet said ﷺ, that the immensity of reward is commensurate with the immensity of the tribulation. The greatness of the reward is matching, is commensurate, is corresponding to the heaviness, the weightiness of the tribulation. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَىٰ إِذَا أَحَبَّ قَوْمٍ إِبْتَلَاهُمْ. And verily, Allah, when He loves a people, He tests them. Verily, Allah, when Allah loves a people, He tests them. He sends tribulations, different types of tribulations. فَمَنْ رَضِيَ فَلَهُ الرِّضَىٰ. The Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever is content, i.e. with the haqiqah level, recognizing that this is from Allah. It doesn't mean not working to solve the tribulation. It doesn't mean not putting in the effort to alleviate the suffering. If someone is sick, they go to the doctor. They take the medicine. If someone is under a type of family problem, they go, they seek counseling. If people are suffering, the people that are not suffering from a particular calamity, the onus is on them, the moral onus is on them to work, to solve, and to help those that are disenfranchised or in difficulty, in dire in painful circumstances. But at the haqiqi level, man radiya falahu ridha, whoever is content with the ultimate destiny behind it, falahu ridha, then they shall receive the contentment of Allah. وَمَنْ سَخِطَ فَلَهُ السُّخْطُ وَلَيَعَذَ بِاللَّهِ. And whoever is upset at Allah, whoever is frustrated at the Divine, whoever objects to what Allah has destined, then they shall get the objection and the frustration back from Allah. وَلَيَعَذَ بِاللَّهِ. And we seek refuge from Allah. We seek refuge from Allah. And so this is why one of the great metaphysicians of our tradition, Abu al-Hasan al-Shadidi, he says that خَصْلَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. There's one specific trait that يُهْمِلُ الْأَعْمَالِ, it nullifies good deeds. وَلَا يَنْتَبِهُ عَلَيْهِ كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ. But the majority of people are unaware of it in their hearts. There's one specific trait that nullifies good deeds, but most people are unaware of it. وَهِيَ, and it is, namely, سَخَطُ الْعَبْدِ عَلَىٰ قَضَاءِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَىٰ, is for the servant to be frustrated at the destiny that Allah has set for them, at the decree that Allah has determined for them. And he mentions the verse from the Quran, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ كَرِهُ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأَحْبَطَ أَعْمَالَهُمْ. That is because they were upset at what Allah sent them. And so Allah rendered their good deeds null and void. And so Allah rendered their good deeds null and void. This verse, of course, refers to the specific context of the revelation, where the people at the time of the Prophet ﷺ who were upset at revelation itself, the wahi. But as an ishara, as an allusion, a spiritual lesson that's in addition, it doesn't replace this tafsir, but in addition, something of benefit that the Imam points out, rahimahullah, is that this is also applicable with the circumstances in our life. Those are also sent by Allah. Those are also sent by Allah. And if someone has karaha, if they're upset at what Allah has set for them, the package of their destiny, then this is a recipe for one's good deeds being nullified. أَحْبَطَ أَعْمَالُهُمْ, that he makes their good deeds just disappear, as if they were nothing. وَلَيْعَذُ بِاللَّهِ. And so this is part of the answer to what's called the problem of suffering. In philosophy, the problem of suffering, part of the answer, and we say part of the answer because the full answer is it takes much time to unpack, and also at the foundation of the answer in our tradition is that we don't question Allah. What the response that's often proffered by philosophers and theists is what's called a theodicy, which is to justify what God does. And the basic response of Ahlus Sunnah is, who are we to justify what Allah does? That's hubristic in its very nature. A theodicy has a type of hubris behind it often. There are various theodicies that are there, that you know, that satisfy the soul at some level. The fact that there is reward in the akhirah, the fact that that you know the time will be taken to account in the next life. There's various wisdoms. We don't deny the wisdoms behind suffering in the world, but at bottom, لا يسألوا عما يفعل لا يسألوا عما يفعل وهم يسألون. As Allah Ta'ala Himself says, Allah is not asked about what He does, but they shall be asked. And so, part of the response to the problem of suffering is to not treat it as an abstract philosophical discourse, as a speculative issue, but rather as a practical issue: is what's the state of my heart when I when I am in a state of suffering, when I am dealt with the blow of fate. What's the state of my heart? Because that's the only answer that matters. That's the only answer that matters. And that's the only answer that can allow us to experience something of Tawheed rather than simply speculating about Tawheed. We affirm Tawheed in the third person when we learn it as Aqidah. Allah is existent, necessarily existent. Allah is without time, without beginning, without end. Allah has no resemblance to His creation. Allah is self-sufficient. Allah is one without partner. Allah is all-powerful, all-knowledgeable, all-willing. Allah is speaking, He hears, He sees. Allah Ta'ala has life. We affirm the attributes of Allah when we learn our aqidah in a third-person perspective. But if we reflect, for example, in the Surah Al-Fatiha, there is a transition from the third-person to the second-person. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, Iyaka Na'budu, Wa Iyaka Nasta'in. This is iltifat, this is a turning, a rhetorical turn. One of the wisdoms that our scholars have derived from this is part of the solution to these problems, is that to not just learn about Allah in the third person, but to actually turn to Allah face to face, as it were, with dua, with supplication, is that the person that is in a state of difficulty, their turn to Allah is part of the answer to the problem of suffering. And that's their answer. My answer is when I turn to Allah, and your answer is when you turn to Allah. And every believer has their own unique experience of the Tawheed of Allah when they turn to Allah in the privacy of their heart, in the most intimate connection that they have with Allah. And this is why the knowledge of Islam is not an abstract knowledge. It's supposed to be implemented in its proper place. One of the famous aphorisms of Imam Junaid, rahimahullah, he says, Al-ilmu yujibu isti'amalahu fi maratibihi. Sacred knowledge necessitates that it's implemented in its proper places. فَمَنْ لَمْ يَسْتَعْمِلْهُ فِي مَرَاتِبِهِ كَانَ عَلَيْهِ لَا لَهُ. That whoever does not implement it in its proper place, it's going to be against them, a proof against them, not a proof for them. And so the most important knowledge to place in its proper place is metaphysics itself. In other words, ilm al-tawheed, it's not simply to learn as an aqidah, although that's the beginning of our journey. But it's supposed to be our way, the lens of the heart, in seeing and experiencing and responding to the events of our lives. The events of our lives. In other words, recognizing that Allah Ta'ala has decided this for me. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, in His infinite knowledge, in His infinite choice, in His infinite power, in His infinite wisdom, in His infinite beauty, in His infinite majesty, in His infinite glory, all of these, the kamalat, la tantahi, the perfections of Allah have no end, that necessarily existent, our Lord has sent this to me. And so it's upon me to turn to Him, Azza wa Jal. It's upon me to turn to Him, Azza wa Jal. And this is the lesson at Ta'if, that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the most difficult, one of the most difficult moments of his life, after in the year of sadness, when he loses his beloved wife, Khadija, Allah be pleased with her, he loses his beloved uncle, Abu Talib. His wife was the spiritual and emotional support, and his uncle was the political and societal support. And then all the asbab are being severed, all the means in the world are being severed. And then at Ta'if, he is ridiculed, he is mocked, he is rejected, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the extent that the people he loved the most, servants and children, throw stones at him. And his blessed body, blood is flowing, his legs, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What does he do? The beautiful dua, where he turns to Allah. See, Allah is not abstract for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah is his direct beloved, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he is the beloved of Allah. And he turns in faqr, iftiqar, need,
Oh Allah, I implore you, ubudiyya, servitude to Allah, that he, affirming that he is the abd and Allah is the rabb. This is the solution to the problem of suffering. That it's not a philosophical solution, it's an experiential solution. And that's the teaching of all the prophets, alayhi wa sallam. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفر الله إن الله غفور رحيم. وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. And so this turning from the third person to the second person, this is not an overnight event for most of us. This is a process, years of working on ourselves, working on the state of our souls, working on the state of our hearts, such that we become people who naturally turn to Allah immediately in the second person, through dua, supplication, and asking Allah for help. And so what are the means, what are some of the means, that the spiritual asbab that we can take to allow our souls to ascend in this movement from the third person to the second person? Two of the most important ones are good company and the remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jal. Good company and the remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, ittaqullah wa kunu ma'as-sadiqeen. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, ittaqullah wa kunu ma'as-sadiqeen. O people of faith, have God consciousness, piety with Allah, and be with the genuine ones. Be with the truthful ones. Be with the authentic ones. In other words, you know, like it said, birds of a feather flock together. If we are around people of a certain way, we will imbibe and imbue and reflect their traits. Al-hal yasri, as our scholars say, the states of people transfer over to other states. If we're around people of generosity, we'll find ourselves wanting to be more generous. But if we're around people who are stingy, then we'll become more and more stingy. And all of the virtues work this way. If we're around people who are in the state of remembrance of Allah, then our heedlessness will be lessened. We'll be more and more aware of the reality of Allah that is omnipresent, that Allah Ta'ala is all-knowing and all-willing and all-powerful behind all the events in the world, that this is Khalqullah Azza wa Jal. But if we're on people that are heedless and unaware of Allah, then we'll become more and more heedless. And this is why the Prophet also said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Abu Dawud relates in his Sunan, that al-mar'u ala deeni khalilihi, that an individual will be on the very religion of his intimate friend. The khalil is someone you spend a lot of time with, your intimate friend. فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَحَدُكُمْ مَنْ يُخَالِلُ. So let each of you look carefully, reflect deeply as to who he keeps intimate company with. General friendship is broad, but intimate friendship, the people of close suhbah, this should be we should be very careful, because we want to absorb the good of the best. We want to absorb the good of the best. And this is particularly important for our young people, but it applies to all of us. And this is why one of the our scholars, Abu Athman al-Hiyari, he says, man sahiba nafsahu, that whoever keeps company with himself, sahibahu al-ujbu, that vanity will keep his company. Narcissism will keep his company. If someone doesn't have good company, then suddenly they're more and more impressed with themselves and their ideas and how smart they are and how much they've accomplished. And the litany of their accomplishments outweighs the litany of the remembrance of Allah. And we seek refuge in Allah from such hearts. مَنْ صَحِبَ نَفْسَهُ صَحِبَهُ الْعُجْبُ وَمَنْ صَحِبَ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ. But whoever keeps the company of the people that Allah loves, whoever keeps the company of the saints of Allah, وُفِّقَ لِلْوُسُولِ إِلَى الطَّرِيقِ إِلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. He will be granted the God-given success to find a path of drawing nearer to Allah. Of drawing nearer to Allah. And so this is what we see. And the most important company is our teachers. And this is one of the calamities of the Ummah today, is that you have spokespeople of the religion that have no sanad in the religion. People that have no talaqi, they have never sat with the people who bequeathed this knowledge, because they were given it and their teachers were given it, and their teachers were given it back to the early generation of the Salaf from the Prophet himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the way that knowledge was transferred in our tradition. And this doesn't negate that we can have innovative thought and, you know, what's called free thinking, but it has to be within certain parameters. Because when it comes to interpretation of scripture, there are certain facts, there are undeniable facts about what the limits of language are and what the interpretive tradition has recognized as sound interpretation. And so that's for the outward, and also for the inward, is that part of our tradition is to have tarbiyah, a teacher of tarbiyah, a teacher of someone that can, again, teach someone how to raise the level of their souls and to embrace prophetic virtue and to cleanse the heart from demonic vice. And this is also a kaiza in our ummah, a calamity in our ummah, is that people are many people who speak about the religion have neither the teachers of the outward nor the tarbiyah of the inward through teachers. And this is why this is also emphasized. The best company, the most important company is the quality of one's teachers, the fact that one should have authentic teachers. This is why the teacher of Imam al-Qushayri, rahimahullah, Abu Ali al-Dabbaq, he was once asked, how does a person straighten out the crookedness of their soul? How does a person straighten out the crookedness of their soul? He says, بِتَأَدُّبٍ بِإِمَامٍ, by receiving adab, by learning etiquette and manners and the prophetic way from a true righteous scholar, an imam. فَإِنَّ مَنْ لَمْ يَتَأَدَّبْ بِإِمَامٍ بَقِيَ بَطَّالًا, because he says, whoever doesn't take their, acquire and inculcate the prophetic way, the manners of the sunnah from an authentic teacher, he remains batalan, just useless. Useless. No matter how much he speaks, no matter how much he might pontificate about his brilliant insights, it's not going to affect the heart because it's not accompanied with the light that comes from talaqi, receiving knowledge from people that have received it, from people that have received it back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so then coupled with good company then is the remembrance of Allah. This is another imperative principle for allowing our teachings of creed and metaphysics to become experienced realities of our heart. This turn from the third person to the second person. But the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sabaqa al-mufarridun, as Imam Muslim, in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, and the Sunan of Tirmidhi relate, that the singularizers have outstripped everyone. The singularizers have outstripped everyone. وَمَنْ مُفَرِّدُونَ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, who are the singularizers, oh, God's emissary, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the version of Sahih Muslim, أَذَّاكِرُونَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَذَّاكِرَاتِ, men and women that make plentiful remembrance of Allah. Men and women that make plentiful remembrance of Allah. And in the version of Sunan of Tirmidhi, أَلْمُسْتَحْتِرُونَ فِي ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, those people that are absorbed in the remembrance of Allah. Those people that are absorbed and never let go of the remembrance of Allah. يَدَعُ الذِّكْرُ عَنْهُمْ أَثْقَالَهُمْ فَيَأْتُونَ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ خِفَافًا. The dhikr of Allah itself, the remembrance of Allah, the remembrance of the Divine, has removed the burdens of their sins. Has removed the burdens of their sins. In other words, not only does it wipe out sins, but it transforms the heart such that the person finds it more difficult to commit sins. فَيَأْتُونَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ خِفَافًا, so they come on the day of resurrection light and easy. Light and easy. And this is the light of the heart. The lightness on the day of judgment is because of the illumination light of the heart. This is why Hakim al-Tirmidhi says, مَا مِن نُورٍ فِي الْقَلْبِ إِلَّا وَمَعَهُ رَحْمَةٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى بِقَدْرِ ذَلِكَ. There's never a light in the heart except that it's accompanied with the mercy from Allah, commensurate to the light. فَمَا دَامَ الْعَبْدُ فِي الذِّكْرِ, so so long as the servant is in a state of remembrance of Allah, فَالرَّحْمَةُ نَازِلَةٌ عَلَيْهِ كَالْمَطَرِ, then mercy is falling upon the person. Mercy is descending upon the person like rain. Like rain. This is the protection of Allah. This is the inayah of Allah. This is the concern of Allah. This is the love of Allah. This is the special يَخْتَصُّ لِرَحْمَتِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ, the unique mercy that Allah selects for only some of His servants, whomever He wills. فَإِذَا غَفَلْ قَحَدْ, but when the person is heedless and unaware of Allah, then there's a drought for the soul. And so illumination of the heart, heavenly rain, spiritual rain for the heart. This is what cultivates a heart that has its own personal answer to the problem of suffering. Its own personal experience answer to the problem of suffering. And these are the hearts of the saints. And they never question Allah. We ask Allah Ta'ala to make us people like that. The Prophet ﷺ would apply the dhikr in all of his contexts. He had a dhikr for putting on a garment. He had a dhikr for entering the home. He had a dhikr for leaving the home. All of the harakat, all of the changes and of physical situations, the event from event, he started with dhikr of Allah Azza wa Jal. And he taught us that it's a protection. Imam Abu Dawud and Tirmidhi and Nasa'i, they all relate the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, مَنْ قَالَ يَعْنِي إِذَا خَرَجَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ. Whoever says, while leaving the house, Bismillah, تُوَكُلْتُ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ, with the name of Allah. Beginning, with the name of Allah. The basmala, what a gift from Allah. What a gift from Allah. And in Ahl Sunnah, al-ism wal-musamma wahidun, that the name and the named are inseparable. In Ahl Sunnah, both our theology and our mystical tradition, al-ism wal-musamma wahidun, the name and the named are inseparable. So if we say Bismillah, then we are accompanied by Allah. Because it's ba' al-musahaba, according to many grammarians, it's the ba' of accompaniment. So that if the name is in our company, then the named is in our company, Azza wa Jal. Bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah. And if Allah is our company, then I rely fully on Allah. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. And there is no might, there is no power. See, now the second, this is applied metaphysics. It's not only about getting it right on an exam or being able to articulate it with a pen and paper. No, realizing. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. There's no might or power. No one can move anything except the power of Allah. No one can keep something still except the power of Allah. These are deep, deep meanings, and it takes years to even start to approximate them. But the hadith, whoever says this, man qala, bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, yuqalu lahu, it's said to him, hudit, wa kufit, wa wuqit, wa tanahha anhu shaytan. This is the mercy now, descending on the person. It is said to that individual, you've been guided, and you've been sufficed, and all your needs are taken care of, and you have a special protection. A special protection. Don't worry about anything. Don't worry about anything. وَتَنَحَّ عَنُهُ الشَّيْطَانِ. And even shaitan can't touch such a person. Untouchable. Even shaitan cannot touch such a person. And in one riwayah, the shaitan says to the other, what do you do about a man that hudiya wa kufiya wa wuqiya? You know, what do you do about a man that's guided and sufficed and protected? They're completely dumbstruck as to how to affect such a person. And that's the greatest protection, is from shaitan and from the ego. Because then the person can be with the prophetic way in their days and their nights. We ask Allah Ta'ala to give us the tawfiq, to experience our tawheed, to experience the tawheed that was bequeathed to us by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We ask Allah Ta'ala to protect us in our days and our nights, to protect our communities, to protect our loved ones, to protect the entire ummah, to protect all of our society. We ask Allah Ta'ala to protect our neighbors. We ask Allah Ta'ala to give us special protection by the blessing of His remembrance, Azza wa Jal. Allahumma faraj anna wa anil muslimin fi kulli makan. Allahumma faraj anna wa anil muslimin fi kulli makan. Allahumma faraj anna wa عن المسلمين في كل مكان. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية والمعافاة التامة في الدنيا والآخرة ولكل مسلم. اللهم إنا نسألك التوفيق والإخلاص ودوام النعمة وحسن الختام. ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية والمعافاة التامة في الدنيا والآخرة ولكل مسلم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وأقيم الصلاة.